Hello, everyone. While you're finishing getting your lunch, my name is Amy Mashburn. I'm the Associate Dean here. And on behalf of the law school, I just want to do a couple of things. Welcome you to this wonderful event and to thank the students and guests who are responsible for having this. The event is, to me, the result of the sort of convergence of several kind of magical and serendipitous things. Among them was a group of highly motivated students, including Chris and Adam, who came to Dean Rush and then belatedly me to begin talking about whether we may be able to do more to have more events or to plan something in this area. And then, as coincidence would have it, Professor Amder Clark sort of fell into our laps, basically. I mean, it's the most extraordinary thing. And I'm just absolutely thrilled that we were able to bring all of this together and make this opportunity available for this group of students, particularly before they do move on and move into the world of practice. This is also, I think, important because this involves coordination and cooperation with individuals on the main campus. And we say that here at the law school as if it's a far, far away place, the main campus. But we've always had people on our faculty who are collaborative and who make those connections. And the administration is really supportive of those efforts. And we would like to see more of this. As far as the, and we've got such a wonderful group of people speaking to you. I was fascinated by what we've seen already. When the mayor of Orlando, Buddy Dyer, was here earlier in the week, he was in law school with me here back in the 80s, and he reminded me of something, which is when you may think parking is bad at the law school now, but in the 80s, we parked in a wooded lot that was unpaved. And so at that time, there was this movement afoot to pave the lot. And what was raised in opposition to this, but that this was a burial site and would have Native American artifacts. And so it is something that has always been a part of the law school's culture. And I'm just extremely delighted that we're using the opportunity of relocating the sign to look at that culture and to explore what's behind it. And the other thing that I would say is that from the beginning, the students were insistent that although we're fascinated by the historical and cultural aspect of this, we also want to make our students aware of what the modern possibilities are for advocacy here and to make a fulfilling life in the law if these are your interests. So in that vein, I'd like to introduce our next speaker. The students have prepared something, but I'll try and sort of weave that in with what I have. Travis Trueblood is a member of the Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma. He was raised in Polk County, Florida. He presently serves as the chief of staff to the Office of the Special Trustee for American Indians at the U.S. Department of the Interior. He's been an attorney for more than 16 years, representing more than 30 tribes during his career, including litigating a case to full restoration for a tribe in California. He's former corporate counsel for the Seminole tribe of Florida and has served as a special assistant to Florida Governor's Counsel on Indian Affairs. He's earned, and here I have some dates for you. He earned a bachelor's degree from FSU in 1997 and a law degree from FSU's College of Law in 2000. He's also has a a master's degree from the University of Miami and is currently completing a PhD at the University of Southern Mississippi. Among the things, and perhaps he will mention this, I do not know, but that I found interesting researching him had to do with the role that that he says it was when he went to college and met other American Indians with the same complexion and began to study Native American tribal cultures that he came to terms with his identity and learned to embrace that culture, and how much he's learned by working directly with leaders from the Seminole tribes. So we are thrilled to have you here. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you all very much for having me today. I certainly hope that I can live up to the hype. So I move around a little bit. I'm a litigator by nature before I kind of joined the government. So if I try not to run too much. I did want to start this morning by want to dedicate my hour with you guys today to someone who's very special to me and also special to the state of Florida. This week, the state lost a cultural icon, a great Seminole elder. Her name is Louise Gopher. Louise died earlier this week. She's 71 years old. Louise was raised traditionally in the Fort Pierce community. She spoke only Creek when her father attempted to enroll her in school in Fort Pierce. At that time, the schools were still segregated, and it created quite a fuss in Fort Pierce. Does she go to the white school, or does she go to the black school? From that time on, Louise has been a trailblazer. She was the first Seminole woman to earn a college degree, and she subsequently went on to become the director of education for the Seminole Tribe of Florida. And many of you who have never met her have seen her, I guarantee it, because she's spoken at many events throughout Florida. In 2014, Governor Scott inducted her into the Florida Women's Hall of Fame. So she's been a constant champion for education within the Seminole Tribe of Florida, which is an important endeavor. She was also instrumental in helping to develop and create the Pemigewasset Imahaga Charter School at the Brighton Seminole Indian Reservation, which is the first state-sponsored charter school on an Indian reservation east of the Mississippi. So it's actually an integrated charter school that works with the county. So there are Native students and non-Native students that go to that school. And that was her life stream before she retired. After she retired, Louise kept her work. She kept up her public speaking, and she worked with the Seminole Tribe's culture department, as well as their Apatiki Museum, in collecting oral histories in the Creek language from elders, which you all kind of heard from Marcus when he opened up the session, that the language is dying. So capturing those oral histories are ever so important. Without those oral histories, we're left with what anthropologists and archaeologists can put together for us. So I want to dedicate what I'm saying today and what I'm hoping to impart with you guys to Louise's memory. And Louise is also the grandmother of my daughter, Isla Trueblood, who goes to her charter school and lives at Wright. So I appreciate your indulgence. I'm not a traditional lecturer, so you guys don't have to just sit there and listen to me, okay? If you got a question, I want you to ask it. Because I remember when I was sitting in your spot, and I never made it to your spot, actually, because I couldn't get into you guys. All right. So you guys are a lot smarter than I am. But I did get into FSU somehow, and I was one of the few Native students at FSU. So I applaud the effort that the Native students here and those that support those efforts have taken. It was a struggle for me at FSU. I tried to do the same thing that your students are doing here, but you'd think that FSU would be a little more open to something. It is the Florida State Seminoles, after all. So I taught, before I took this job, I was teaching as an adjunct at Florida State, and I would drive from my home on the Brighton Reservation 6 hours to Tallahassee every Thursday to teach my Indian law class. which, you know, I didn't pay that much, so I was kind of paying to teach the class. I'm like, come on, guys. So I applaud UF for being a leader, and I hope that effort continues. I knew I wanted to do Indian law from the beginning, okay? Like when I first went to FSU. And just like kind of here at UF, you guys were able to kind of get a class rouse. FSU didn't have an Indian law class. They didn't know even where to begin. It just me as a Native American person, I probably knew more than any teacher that they could readily find in school. Nonetheless, they were able to get a lifelong friend and mentor of mine, who's retired from the First District Court of Appeals, Judge James Jonas, to teach the course. And I took the class, but I actually kind of helped him program the class. So that was kind of how it began for me. The rest, I had to cobble together my own Indian law curriculum. I took classes like federal jurisdiction, property law classes, and I took constitutional law, like things that I thought would be a good base to go forward. And why is all of that important to you? It's important because, you know, there are universities that have Indian law curriculums. And that's great. Arizona State has one, University of Wisconsin has one. Fantastic. Get on it. What I want to talk to you about today is what Indian law is in Florida, and it's different. And the great professors you have here, they'll tell you a lot of the great case law and major cases and statutes and this, that, and the other. Yeah, well, that's the same. But what I'm talking about is the application. So when you have a question, I want you to ask me. If you want to ask me something about James Billy, Chief James Billy, ask me. You want to ask me why the Miccosukees don't have a compact, ask me. I'll tell you. Because also, while I was going to Florida State, I had the privilege of working for two Florida governors doing Indian stuff. I worked for Walken Lawton Governor Childs, that was interesting. I went deer hunting with him, and he called me the Indian guy. I'll leave you in the room. And then I also worked for Governor Bush. So I've kind of seen it done both ways. So it's been a fantastic experience for me and to be here today to talk to you all specifically on this topic, because this is what I wanted to do. I wanted to do Indian law in Florida. I didn't want to have to go do Indian law in New Mexico. That's fine. They got people to do that. I'm talking about what happened here and what's happening on the undercurrent here. I was telling the dean just a minute ago, I use a lot of these southern euphemisms when I talk because, after all, I was raised in Polk County, which is not that far from here, so don't hold that against me. I told the dean that you can't swing a dead cat around here and not hit some sort of piece of Indian history. And that includes right here on this campus. Okay. So, with that, I have a loose outline of things that mine is more topical in nature. And because I expect that you guys will have questions. And largely, you know, to a certain extent, at least in recent times, in the time we have, we don't have time to get to a lot of legal stuff. Like, I'm not going to give you a case to write down the citation. We're just going to talk about it. But largely in recent times, Indian law in Florida, I have on my outline, Indian law equals business law. Really. So, and when I'm talking about business law, I'm talking about billions of dollars. Okay? The Seminole Tribe of Florida's revenues alone last year, just from their gaming endeavors, were about $1.4 billion. Does that get you excited? That's a huge shot into Florida's economy, $1.4 billion. And that doesn't take into account the fact that they also own the Hard Rock Cafe empire. Not just the one in Miami or the one in Orlando, like the whole thing. The one they have in Abu Dhabi. The one they have in downtown Washington, D.C. They own all of it. All the holdings, all the property, the hotel casino in Vegas, the two resorts in the Dominican Republic, all of it. So that $1.4 billion figure doesn't include that. So it's not important. It's important. It's important. And I'm fortunate to be speaking to all of you because, you know what, at this great institution that you guys are at, I'm not just blowing you up because you're at UF, but, you know, let's cut to the chase. every one of you in here is going to take the bar and pass. Some of you, all of you are going to become lawyers. Some of you are going to become judges. Some of you are going to become legislatures, senators. One of you might be the governor. One of you might be the president. I want you to remember that at some point in your career, you know what? I remember somebody saying that when it came to Indian law in Florida, things were a little bit different. There's a very good chance that whatever big law firm you get hired at, you'll know more about Indian law than the 20-year partner that's sitting right next to you. He won't admit it, but you will. And I'm not blowing smoke because it happened to me. I got hired by Holland and Knight when I first started. I was the first Native American they hired to help them launch their Indian law practice. You know what I knew? Absolutely zero. Was I at the top of my class at FSU? No, was not. But I got hired because they were looking for specialized knowledge. And they were looking to kind of booster some of their minority diversification efforts. So it's also fitting that I'm in this room because Chesterfield Smith, who's staring at me right back there, was a great mentor to me. As was Park Hill Mays and a lot of other great UF alumni. So everything's kind of coming together today. So what I'd like to do is just talk to you a little bit about, and you know, our first speaker gave a pretty good historical account of Native American things in Florida. And I don't have the time to go through the history of everything, but some of it is kind of important to mention. But I think to build on his presentation, you all kind of get the idea that originally, you know, there were these kind of pre-colonial Indians who occupied Florida. And a lot of them kind of, when the Spanish first came here, the Spanish explorers kind of interacted with them. The Spanish tried to round some of them up in the beginning and take them to Havana and use them as slaves. That didn't work out. And then they tried converting them with kind of mixed results. And so you can kind of see how that pre-colonial time worked out. A lot of them were decimated by diseases and wars. But my point is that, you know, in Florida, you had Spanish rule, then you had kind of French and British rule, and then went back to Spanish. So here's what my outline kind of says. I think you get a kick out of this. Missions and Spanish conquest. You kind of heard about that. The British are coming. Now, what was interesting about the British's time here in Florida, at least how they interacted with the Indians, is the British weren't really interested in the Indians who were here. They only held on to Florida and interacted with the Indians here to harass the Americans. So there was this huge thing during the War of 1812 where Florida was more or less used as a pawn. That kind of perpetuated back into when the British gave Florida back to Spain. Spain did the same thing. And then the French, I have on my outline, come and go, but not really. So the French were in kind of the western part of Florida, barely interacted with the Indians, only to very limited degrees. The British tried to arm Indians, kept them at peace, much like they had done in the colonies in Virginia. So when Florida went back to the Spanish, this is what I have on my list, Spanish conquest, part deux, but not really. This is where it gets interesting, because when Spain got Florida back a second time, they didn't really do much with it, but they did send arms and weapons to the Indians here to continue the British tradition of kind of harassing the colonials. Now, what that translated into is, but there weren't really, Spain was losing its empire at that time. When they finally gave it back to the United States, by that time, Andrew Jackson had already been making incursions into Florida. The southern states were completely ticked off because they saw Florida as a slave haven. Slaves running to Florida, and we can't go get them because they're in Spanish held Florida. By that time, towards the end there, I think the actual treaty was in 1819, but it wasn't effective until 1821. Andrew Jackson was already in Florida, regularly raiding Florida. Now, that's a historical perspective. Culturally, what you need to know is by that time, most of the kind of pre-colonial Indian people that were here were gone. They either died, or a lot of them joined other tribes, culturally. The Amassis came to Florida, but also what you don't hear very often is there were other tribes in Florida. My tribe, the Choctaws, the Cherokees, the Creeks, the Chickasaws, they all came here, but on kind of partial basis. They would come down here, hunt deer, take all the hides back. So they were never full-time kind of settlements. The full-time settlements start to come when the Creeks in Alabama, there was a war within the Creek Nation that was partially motivated, constructed, and assisted by the United States government. The Lower Creeks and the Upper Creeks. You had some that were kind of mixed-blood Creeks, and then you had some that were more traditional people. The more traditional people started seeking and making permanent homes into Florida. And that's how their association with the state began. Almost immediately, once the United States kind of took over control of Florida, Andrew Jackson became the first territorial governor of Florida. Mm-hmm. Was a really good day for Indians. He once bragged, or it's alleged that he bragged from his porch of the governor's mansion in Tallahassee as he put his boots up on his rail, that his boots were made of Indian skins. So when you see some people protest in Tallahassee every year during the springtime Tallahassee event, that's why. Because the leader of the springtime Tallahassee event is usually an Andrew Jackson figure, and so he holds that special place in Florida. Needless to say, you know, Andrew Jackson's experience with Florida and what a lot of the Southern states were saying, that slaves were coming to Florida, wasn't entirely false. They were coming to Florida. And even within a lot of them were joining Seminole communities. Within the Seminole tribe, there are people who can trace their lineage and descendants back to slaves. And the community in Fort Pierce, the Fort Pierce Seminole community, is a large community of people that are descended from those original people. They came to Florida seeking freedom. A lot of them found it. They were accepted into the tribe and welcomed. The Seminoles looked at it as if these people are willing to fight our common foe, then they are also our ally. So that history is there, and it's very real. And they have a very unique story as well. So almost immediately, once the United States got the territory back, the First Seminole War kind of starts. I'm not going to beat you the head over history because we want to get to the juicy stuff, but you know that there were three Seminole Wars, basically. The United States could never really, they could never really win the wars. So eventually, it became one of the most costly wars in American history. And those in dollars at that time, it's estimated that on those three wars, the United States spent in excess of $40 million. So $40 million in 1821 dollars, I don't even know how much, but a lot. Eventually, they kind of gave up, and a lot of Seminole people along the way, different chiefs had signed treaties and left. Micanopy, which is down the street here, he signed over and he left. But not all of them left. And the Seminole as a people are a very independent people. A lot of that even carries over today. So the problem with the treaties and the frustration of the United States was, is, well, we thought we made a treaty with these people, and they're not leaving. They're still fighting us. And from the Seminole perspective, they're very democratic people, almost like a one person, one vote type of thing. So they're saying, well, that person didn't speak for me. This Micanopy lives way up there, you know. I have nothing in common with him. He doesn't represent me. So that's how these wars kept perpetuating. And eventually, the population was decimated down to about 200 or so people who kind of hid out in the other ways. The United States government just said, you know what? We got bigger problems. Just stay there. Whatever. Stay. So that brings me kind of up to a little more modern times, in a way. You should also know that, you know, well, a lot of Seminoles were removed to Oklahoma during the Trail of Tears. And a lot of people, some of the people might ask me, they say, well, who are these people that are in Oklahoma? Are they Seminole too? How did that happen? Well, they're people who a lot of their ancestors agreed to remove themselves, so they left and they went to Oklahoma. And so what's the relationship today between the folks in Oklahoma and the folks in Florida? They're very distant relatives. They share some of the same common customs, but largely, believe it or not, they're not as close as you would think in terms of how they interact with each other. There was an attempt to, in the late 1980s, the Seminole Nation of Oklahoma was seeking to get some land in northern Florida and make a casino for themselves, because the Seminole tribe of Florida would not share any of their casino revenues with them. And that was reacted to very badly and went nowhere. So even though they're related, they're distantly related, there is also an undercurrent within the Seminole tribe that says, you know, we are related to these people, but we chose to stay and fight, and they chose to leave. So that's the difference. Those people are things that want to move on. All right. So let's talk about a little bit more modern claims. Seminole tribe of Florida, who are they? Well, they're not really one tribe. They are today, but they're composed of several people, primarily Creeks, but also Choctaws, Chickasaws, Cherokees, Yamasee. They all came together in Florida. And also the original people that were here. A lot of those original Indians, the Timucua, Apalachee, Calusa, not all of them died. Some of them joined. And also run with them. Language base, as you've already heard, is primarily Creek. You will find mixed in Spanish words from time to time, because they don't have words for certain things, so they adopted those early Spanish words. And some of the things that, it's interesting, even some of the foods, and a couple of foods and things like that are similar to some of the Spanish traditions. A lot of the Seminole people like to credit, they're very proud of their heritage with cattle. And they do trace that all the way back to Cowcatcher, who was close by. So once the Spanish kind of left the first time they were here, a lot of the Indians around here just rounded up all the cattle and all the hogs that they found. And that became kind of part of who they were as an industrious people. Frustrated the dickens out of the British and the French and the Americans as they began to incur further in Florida, because the way they looked at it is if they saw these cows over here, and then if they could round them up and you weren't there, then that was it. But it was a huge source of problems in Florida for a long time. So I talk a lot about the Seminole tribe of Florida because that's who I worked with. What are the tribes around Florida?
Miccosukee.
Who are the Miccosukee? You don't hear about them as much, do you? Well, the Miccosukee are similar to the Seminole in probably 90% of their ways, okay? They are, think of it, the best way to kind of think of it is, imagine they live in a different town and have a different mayor. That's the easiest way to kind of put it. They live primarily west of Miami, along the Tamiami Trail there, and then they have a small reservation, which they really don't claim, which you've probably driven through, when you go across 75 from Fort Myers to Fort Lauderdale. That reservation where the only gas station is, there's only like 20 people that live there. And it's because it's never really been their reservation. It was kind of given to them by President Taft in the early part of the century in exchange for some other land that the United States government kept. The Miccosukee are similar to the Seminole in many ways. Many people consider them more traditional. They're a more closed society. They kind of keep to themselves. They speak a sub-dialect of the Creek language that's called Miccosukee. which many people in the Seminole tribe speak, actually, with the exception of one community, which is the Bryan community, which speaks Creek, the same that the Creek that's spoken in Alabama and in Oklahoma. It's a little bit different language, and they have different leadership, but essentially the same people. But they are completely different in how they run their affairs. I mean, they're very close. They have a tribal court system. They can have lay advocates, or you can have attorneys, but your attorney has to know how to speak Miccosukee. Only Miccosukee is spoken in the courtroom. So they're very closed. There was a law that was called the Indian Self-Determination Act. It was enacted in the 1970s, and it gave tribes the opportunity to contract for themselves many of the services that the United States government was to provide for them. As soon as that law came about, one of the provisions allows basically for the government to just give you the money and see it. They're not in your affairs at all. As soon as Miccosukee had the chance to do that, they took it. So they really are, they desire to have nothing to do with the federal government and limit our interaction with the state. Always on their terms. Any other tribes in Florida? There's a new one. There's a new player on the block. Nobody's talking about it. The Porch Band of Creek Indians. Why am I talking about it? Because they have 2 acres of reservation land that straddles the border of Alabama and Florida. What? What? I thought we only had Seminole Miccosukee. That's what everybody in the state is saying. That's what Governor Scott said when he got a letter on his desk that said, we have about 2 acres in the state of Florida, and we want to put a casino, you know, we'd like to put a casino there. What do you think of that? Where is it? It sat on Governor Scott for his desk for the last 2 years. He doesn't know what to do with it. He wasn't expecting that. So the Porch Band of Creek Indians is predominantly located in Atmore, Alabama, which is about 40 miles, I think, from Pensacola. Not that far over the border. They have a couple of successful gaming facilities in Alabama, and they're now starting to expand into Florida. They had traces into Escambia County and the Western Panhandle of Florida for some time. There's a state-recognized tribe in Florida called Muscogee Nation of Florida. It used to be called the Florida Tribe of Eastern Creeks. They are distantly related to the Porch Creeks. The difference is that when Porch Creek was officially recognized by the United States government in the 1980s, the deal that was struck and the legislation that recognized the Porch Creeks specifically excluded those Creeks who lived in Florida. That's the difference. And boy, did they lose out. So anyway, you all, as you go on in your career, you may deal with the third tribe in Florida, the Porch Band of Creek Indians. We're primarily in Alabama, but also the Western Panhandle of Florida. There's a quarter horse track that's in Gretna, which is near Quincy, just west of Tallahassee, that has poker. Porch Creek owns that horse track. They also own half of the dog track in Jacksonville. They're thinking ahead. How is the Florida market going to work for them? Even if it's not an on-reservation business, how do we get into this gaming business with this specialized knowledge that we have in this skill? All right. There's a fourth one, kind of an iffy one. This one, these people are very interesting. You never hear about them. There are a group of traditional Seminoles that live in the Everglades. I did some legal work for them because they live wholly within the Big Cypress National Preserve on campsites. No electricity, no running water. Their numbers are dwindling. They are eligible to be either Seminole or Miccosukee tribal members. Historically, they choose not to do so because they believe that if they were to, it goes back to a judgment fund that was created for this taking of Seminole lands in Florida. They believe that ideologically, if they accept the money, that then they've kind of given up that claim, and from a spiritual standpoint, affects their ability to be indigenous, because then they've now submitted. But their numbers are dwindling. So their future is kind of to be continued. And now we get to some of the fun stuff. So I told you that I worked for two Florida governors, right? And so, you know, a lot of you haven't taken Indian law, so you don't know if somebody tells you they're Indian, or, you know, they tell you they're from a tribe or something like that, you kind of believe them, right? There's distinction. We have a lot of groups here in Florida who claim that they're tribes. And there's a line that gets blurred. There's a line between being culturally Native American or being a descendant of a Native American and being a member of a tribe. And when I say a tribe, I mean a member of a federally recognized tribe. And the difference is there's a cultural distinction and there's a political distinction. Closely related, no doubt. But to a lot of lay people, they often don't know the difference. Like, I don't know, 10 years ago, the sheriff of Alachua County didn't know the difference when a group of people here in Alachua County had decided to put up a sign and said that this was their reservation. They told the sheriff that he couldn't go on their land. The sheriff didn't know, so he calls the governor. He didn't go out there for 2 weeks. So there, you know, there's a list of people like that throughout the state. So when you all move into your practices and who you deal with, there is a distinction. And here's the term. The above term is, are you a federally recognized tribe? Okay? There's a list that's published by the Department of Interior every year. And it lists every one of the 567 federally recognized tribes. If you're not on the list, no matter what kind of wild explanation they try and give you, because they will try and give you some wild explanation, if you're not on the list, you're not a federally recognized tribe. I'm not saying you're not a Native American person. You might very well be, ethnically, culturally. I'm talking about a political designation. I'm talking about having jurisdiction over a territory and a people. Okay? So that's an important thing to keep in mind. Federally recognized tribes and state-recognized tribes. I work in the governor's office in Florida. We were constantly, there are many, many groups here in Florida who set themselves out as tribal entities that have a jurisdiction over land, and they have different powers, law enforcement, courts, and this, that, and the other. And it's a very slippery slope if you don't know the difference. And it's very important. And there are a lot of them. And there are a lot of them around here. But officially, there's only one state-recognized tribe in Florida, and it's Muscogee Nation of Florida. The others, I understand. Like I said, and I know you don't want to get into this with them, somebody, I'm not saying you're not Native American. I'm just saying this isn't a federally recognized tribe. These things get very, very serious. But know that there's a distinction. So there are essentially three federally recognized tribes in Florida. Seminole Tribe of Florida, Mississippi Tribe of Indians, and Portsmouth. Most of the Portuguese people kind of live in Westmont. That's not to say that there aren't other Indian people in Florida. Florida actually has a larger Native American population than you would think. There are a lot of like random people here, like me, who came here because your parents came here, so you end up as a Floridian. People that are associated with the military come here for jobs. There's a large number of Lummi Indians here in Florida. They worked in the turpentine industry and around this area, and also in the Panhandle. So there are these issues are more common than you think, and they do come up. Any questions so far? Yes, sir.
Just earlier, you said when you were hired by Holland and Knight that they hired you because you had specific knowledge.
Yes.
So they were motivated either culturally or economically or some mixture of both.
Yeah.
To engage in this area of law. Did you find once you took that position that it was commensurate with your motivations and
how did that That's a good question. You know, Adam, from the first time we met this summer when I was in D.C., and I think I kind of blew his wig back a little bit because I'm a different kind of lawyer and I'm a different kind of Indian lawyer. And the difference is, I'm going to say I'm home, but I'll give it to you straight, okay? I've made my whole career giving it to people straight. Adam got like an hour and a half of me just giving it to him straight. All right? Nobody helped me with my Indian law career. I don't owe anything to anybody. I have my own success. I worked at Holland and I for 2 years, and then I started my own practice doing Indian law and other stuff here in Florida. Iron Knight hired me. It was a great experience. I was checking the box, okay? They wanted to start their Indian law practice, but they also wanted to say they had a Native American who worked there. So it was a great opportunity. I'm very appreciative for it, but I felt a little used, to be honest with you. I was a brand new attorney, like many of you guys are getting ready to be. I would go out, they sent me out to tribal communities and say, this is when gaming was really starting to get hot. They'd say, okay, well, we want you to go out and talk to this tribe. See if you can get them to sign up with Holland and I. You want their business. Go out there, do the song and dance, talk to them. You know, these people are loving it. Oh, wow, Holland and I, huge law firm, they have a Native American attorney. Thought we could really do something to help some of these tribes. Go back to the office, Washington, D.C., say, great, I think we got some new Indian clients. This is going to be fantastic. This is what they want to do, blah, blah, blah. Oh, okay, well, you just give us that work. We're going to do this. We need you to go to Arizona and talk to this other tribe. Well, wait a minute. I just promised these people I was going to do this. Oh, no, don't worry about that. We got it. We got it under control. So you get back out there and you just go get us some more clients. I was a used car salesman for 2 years, basically, is what I was. Because every piece of work I brought back got turned over to somebody else to do. And then, at the end of the year, not that I'm stomping on big law, at the end of the year, guess what I got? Well, your billable hours are a little bit low. Well, you sent me to Oklahoma for an entire month and gave me a card and a rental car and said, drive around Oklahoma and get us clients. How do you think my billable hours are? That was early. I think things have changed. I pray they've changed. They changed for me because I just decided I was going to do it my way. But that's just me. I hope I answered your question. I might have just got myself worked up for another reason. But I just want you guys to know that, you know, and especially for the minority students in the room, when you go and, you know, you know what they're trying to do. If they're trying to build their minority path partners or associates or something like that, check out that commitment to what they're doing. I was just so happy to be at this huge law firm because I didn't have the grades to be there, okay? So I was willing to take a little shine, you know? But you guys think about that when you interview. And you ask them what their commitment is. You need to make that decision on what you're comfortable with and who you are. Anyway, sorry. Any other questions? I could talk to you guys all day. I got it in the tank. I'm good. I'm wound up. Yeah.
So that federal designation is really the barrier to a tribe that is not registered federally to have gaming rights.
Absolutely.
So, is there anything that precludes tribes that maybe by ethnicity and blood could have those rights with appropriate lawyering from gaining those rights?
There are still opportunities out there like that, and there's a federal process called the federal acknowledgement process that looks at a set of categories, if you will, where the Department of Interior will take an application supporting materials to make that determination. With that being said, that process is extremely lengthy. There are tribes who've been in that process for 30 years. So there are basically three ways to make a tribe. There's a kind of administrative federal acknowledgement process through the Department of Interior. There's executive orders, like the president can actually recognize the tribe, which I think the last president that did might have been Clinton as he was going out the door. There's legislative action. The Forge Creeks were kind of determined legislatively and act of Congress. That happens on occasion, very rare. But executive order is extremely rare. Oh, and then there's one other one. And that's how there's the newest tribe has come about. Judicial, which is can be lengthy. But the newest tribe in Long Island was kind of recognized by judicial decision. So there's basically four ways. They're all very expensive. But economically, for some tribes, if they could weather the storm and if their end goal is having a casino or some other type of business, the right partner, it can make good economic sense for them and their partner. Yes, sir.
How does one enroll in a tribe?
Very interesting question. So each tribe, as part of their sovereign right, has the right to determine what their membership will be. A lot of it is done by blood quantum, which usually is linked back to some government role, if you will. And others have no blood quantum. They just want to show that you have a direct ascendancy to that tribe. But each one sets its own definition for membership and citizenship. Yes, sir.
Thank you again for your talk. I'm a PhD student in archaeology, and I work predominantly African-American and African sites. One of the discussions that's going around in archaeology now is about African-American graves, protection and retribution. And I was wondering if you've had any experience litigating NAGPRA in Florida or around the country, and if you've seen any pluses, minuses, challenges.
I'll tell you, it's NAGPRA is kind of a constant endeavor. And we have some experts in the room who've actually dealt with NAGPRA. But I can tell you here in Florida, the state a lot of times will try and get around it in a lot of ways. The one I worked on was the Miami Circle. Anybody heard about that? Very peaceful, very valuable piece of land in downtown Miami, and right on the inlet. And they found some kind of the ancient pre-colonization type Indian artifacts there. And you know, they basically want to. Florida treats it as kind of a business deal a lot of times, so they'll try and get out of it. And well, you know, are you willing to, in lieu of excavating this or doing this, how about we give you this land? Blah 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 blah. Biggest example of that is in Tampa. So you all probably been to Tampa. It's not that far from here. You know where the Hard Rock is, right? Well, the Hard Rock, before it was there, that actually was a little community, like a small Seminole community. It's one of the reservations, but the tribe decided to tear that down and make it all an economic endeavor. Before that, you know what it was? I don't even know if you know what this is. It was Zaire's. You know what Zaire's is? It's like a Kmart. There's like an old Kmart shopping center there and like a flea market. Nothing Indian about that site whatsoever. Seminole tribe got that site because there was an NAGPRA site in downtown Tampa that was even more valuable. You know where the old Fort Brooke parking garage is? Near Harbor Island, that area? Well, there was a fort there. And the fort that was there is where they would take a lot of people that they were going to remove to Oklahoma. And there was a huge burial site there. So when they decided to build that parking garage, which you may park at sometime if you ever go to the, I forget what they call it there, go watch a lightning game or a concert or something. Whatever that amphitheater thing is, Ice Palace or whatever. That used to be like a fort, and it had an actor site there. And the state kind of got in there, and they knew it was an actor site, and tried to get around it and said, well, you know what? How about this? We'll let you repatriate the bones. And we're viewing this other land over here that you see this playmark. So a lot of times, you know, there's the legal part of NAGPRA and what that may mean for the African American community as well. But it's funny how all these things kind of come back to our business. Because people will look to find solutions that make everybody happy anyway. But there are still significant challenges here in Florida. Here's one of the games they play in Florida. Well, you know, these were kind of like pre-colonial Indians, so we don't really know who their ancestors are, so we're not really sure. We reached out to the Seminole Miccosukee tribe and the Seminole Nation of Oklahoma, but nobody really got back to us, so, you know, there's a lot of that that goes on in Florida. There's not a lot of, we reached out to Seminole Nation of Oklahoma, Seminole Tribe of Florida, the Miccosukees, the Porch Band, we reached out to the Chickasaw Nation of Oklahoma, we reached out to the Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma, we reached out to the Mississippi Choctaws, we reached out to the Eastern Band of Mississippi, the Choctaw Cherokees, we reached out to the Chittimacha Tribe in Louisiana, the Cushata, the Genovanda Choctaw in Louisiana. What I'm getting at is rather than sending out this blast to 14 or 15 tribes through the southeast who might have had a hunting camp here at one time and actually may be interested in these ancestors, we send it out to like three or four tribes, and that's it. Call it a day. We've complied with the law. Move along. So those are the things, like when you're talking about that, those are the things that would be of concern to me moving forward. How do you make sure, when the notification part of it is done, how do you make sure that they're really complying with the spirit of that? Yes, sir?
From your time in law school to now, in your position as chief of staff at the office, special trustee, have you been able to fulfill your goals and, I guess, the reason behind why you got into this field, and I guess what projects or that you can speak of more specifically helped you?
I've been fortunate to work on a lot of different really cool things, which is why I kind of wanted to do this. I pray to God I'm not done yet, and that the best is still to come. But one of the best things I worked on was actually not in Florida. It was in California. And that was helping a tribe that had been kind of terminated during the termination era. There was a time in the 1950s where United States was kind of strapped with money. You know, it was a nuclear family. Everybody had house, kids, you know, the whole thing. They had a way that they wanted America to look, and it wasn't the Indian way. On top of that, the money thing, and this plays into Florida too, and the United States government says, you know what, we're just going to, like, start terminating these tribes because we don't want to pay for this anymore. What does termination mean? What it means is terminating that relationship with the federal government. I'll tell you the Florida part of that in a minute, but I'll tell you the answer to your question now. They passed a law in California called the Rancheria Act, California Rancheria Act. And they went through pretty much wholesale through the tribes in California. And there are a lot of tribes in California. They mostly call themselves Rancherias or Mission Indians because they're kind of built from that tradition. And they went to each one of these tribes, and a lot of them were really poor. And they said, listen, we're going to cut a deal with you. We're going to build you a school, we're going to build you like a nice neighborhood, like a cul-de-sac, and a, you know, water plant, and this, that, and the other, and all you guys have to do is just give up your tribal status. Provide vocational training for your people, but you're not going to be a tribe anymore, okay? You cool with that? They went to California, they did this to 46 different tribes. You know how many of those agreements they funded? You know how many water plants were built? Answer's easy, none. None. Not one. So they passed the law, and they Congress never funded it. They told the Bureau of Indian Affairs, just do that out of your normal operating budget. Like, build them a school and all this stuff, and get the people trained. And they're like, what? This is the most underfunded agency ever in the history of government agencies. How are we supposed to do this additional burden? We couldn't meet these people's needs to begin with. Anyway, my point is that almost all of those tribes, through either executive order, legislative action, or primarily lawsuits have been restored. So when you go to California, like you go to San Diego or something, those tribes are outside of San Diego, this is their legacy. Those ones near Sacramento, this is their legacy. They exist because they were terminated. They're called restored. And I had a restoration case. So I took a group of tribal people that had this unique status and never were given what they bargained for in the beginning. And we were able, through judicial action, to get that restored. Government settled. So that, so far, that's been one of the coolest things I've done. But I'm praying I get to do something amazing here in this city. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was fascinated to hear that there may be living descendants of the Apalachee, the Timucua, and the other tribes that were theoretically wiped out. Is there any DNA evidence to support that?
Maybe
archaeologists
know. I don't know that, and Marcus may know, actually, because I asked when I first started working with the Seminole tribe. I was intrigued by that, too. And I was told by tribal elders that they actually gave me a name, and they said, this person who died in, they were old, they died in like 1947 or something. They said this person was Seminole, but they identified themselves as Appalachian. And many of the Seminole people, I've heard this too, Marcus may know better than I've heard some of them say, well, the taller people are really from the older people. Like, they say that within their tribe, if you're tall, you're from some of those more traditional pre-colonial Indians that existed. Like the Apalachee, I think, were one of the ones that were said to be really tall people. How much of that is real and how much of that is folklore, I don't really know. But when you get into some of their traditions and you really get into some of the cultural stuff and you start thinking about where did these things really come from, because not all of it's Creek. And it comes a lot, I think, from some of these pre-colonial traditions. Yes.
So you mentioned that there are, you know, federally recognized tribes and there are tribes that are not federally recognized, but that they may still be Native people.
Yeah.
What happens to them?
They're, you know, like culturally, like, glad you're a Cherokee, but you're not a member of the Cherokee tribe. Like, that's great, you can celebrate your heritage, this, that, and the other, but they're not entitled to government benefits and things like that. That's the difference. And it's really kind of a weird, murky world because a lot of them, and it actually kind of sucks in a way, because a lot of them broke. There are people that are 100% Native American, 100%, no question. But they don't have enough blood quantum from any one tribe to be a member of that tribe. So culturally, and like historically they are, but politically, like as a political designation, they're not.
Wow.
It's just one of these weird kind of...
So they just fall into this hole? Wow.
They're like in a weird void. And I know I'm getting close on time, but... Yes?
I wanted to ask you, well, I'll just say real quick, I've been doing a mitochondrial DNA study on Southeastern Indigenous peoples, but I don't want to say anything about it until I published a paper, so I'll email it to you. But I have a question for Travis.
It's a teaser.
What would you say are kind of the most outstanding points about what makes Florida Indian law different, or the legal context for Native people?
Ah, okay, very interesting. Let me get to this. Listen, I can sit up here all day long, and I know you guys don't have all day long, so I'm going to make sure I drop a couple things on you real quick before I have to go. What Marcus is bringing up, there is something here that's very peculiar in Florida, and that's why I say Indian law in Florida is different. Some of you have heard of something called Public Law 280. Some of you have. Public Law 280 is something that came about in the 1950s. It was a law that was passed by the United States Congress, signed into law without hesitation by the president at the time. And what it said is that if you have, it said certain states, you will take civil and criminal jurisdiction over the Indians within your states. We're out of it. Federal government, we're out. It's on you, states. And then they gave the option to other states. Well, if you have any sort of Indian reservation or whatever in your state, you have the option to take jurisdiction over them. There were a handful of states who opted in, But then shortly thereafter gave it back. You know why they gave it back? The feds didn't give them any money. That's why. There's one that opted in and is hanging on to it. Guess which one it is? This state. Why? Because there's no real answer. Why are they hanging on to it? Because they just want to maintain that control. So, as a matter of course, in this state, the state courts have both civil and criminal jurisdiction over things that happen on the reservation. Criminal cases, car accidents, all that stuff. That's why it matters to you guys. Even if you think you're not gonna have anything to do with Indian law, you can go work for Morgan and Morgan for the people. And, you know, somebody has a car wreck, I don't know, the Hard Rock over here in the parking lot. Two cars. One person doesn't want to pay. Going to state court. That's not to say it won't have a tribal implication, because tribes have their own laws. All these tribes here in Florida also have their own courts. Seminole tribes just stood theirs up a year ago. Miccosukees is very traditional. Seminole tribes is not. Each one of you, once you pass the bar, costs $25. You can practice with one. Related divorces, child dependency matters. If you're in Fort, there's a small group of lawyers in Fort Lauderdale, about 25 of them, that are doing that. Opportunities. Way to differentiate yourself from the next applicant. So that's something that I want to mention as well. I got a whole list of stuff here. But something that's a pet project, I'll cut to the chase because I only have to one, right? Oh, and I'm already over, of course. All right. Florida enacted this legislation to adopt jurisdiction Public Law 280. It's in Florida Statutes 285. There's a whole statute in Florida that deals with Indian stuff. It's 285, if you ever need to look at it. It also sets up each one of the reservations as a special improvement district, just so you know. What's that mean? Reedy Creek Special Improvement District is Walt Disney World. They have their own fire department, they can issue bonds, police department. All the Seminole and Miccosukee tribal police under Chapter 285 are considered state officers, so they have state arrest powers. So 285, remember that, if it ever deals with Indian stuff in Florida. There are a couple other mentions in the Florida statutes that deal with Indian stuff. This is one you might run into in practice. There's a zoning and planning exemption for these traditional cheeky dwellings. A lot of people like to have them by the pool or by some tiki bar by the beach in Fort Myers or something. You don't have to get a permit for that. That's worth the price of admission, folks. Somebody's going to come to you and they're going to be like, hey, listen, you know, City of Palm Coast just gave me a code violation because of my cheeky hut. You say, oh, was it built by a Seminole Indian? Yep. Oh, well, you don't have to have it. That's in there, too. License plates. Have you ever seen a license plate here in Florida that says Seminole Indian or Miccosukee Indian on it? If you live on the reservation, they gave you the option, you can get a license plate for free. Because, you know, you live on the reservation, so they're not supposed to tax you, the state tax. In many other states, tribes have their own license plate. My tribe has one. It says Choctaw Nation of Oklahoma. That's our real license plate. Kind of goes through the state of Oklahoma. Along the line of Florida's tradition in the Public Law 280, and we want all the power, we're not really sure about your sovereignty thing. Instead of giving a license plate to Seminole and Miccosukee tribal members, it says Seminole Tribe of Florida or Miccosukee Tribe of Indians. What does it say? It says Seminole Indian or Miccosukee Indian. It recognizes the person, but it doesn't recognize the government. Just something to think about. These little musings that I have. Okay? My pet project, and then three more things, and I promise I'll let you out here. My pet project, I found when I was doing my adjuncting a few years ago at Tallahassee, I had a lot of time. I'd drive 6 hours from Brighton to go teach my class. So I was like, well, you know, law school is right next to the state archives. I'm just going to go over there and see what they have. I've identified in the Florida Code about four laws, ancient kind of Florida laws that were never really repealed that are kind of racist. Which begs the question, because they're not really being printed anymore, so they're really still a law. I don't know, but I would like to see them repealed. So you may see this. One of them says that if you find an Indian in Florida, you can deliver them to the nearest military post or post office and be paid a bounty, because that Indian will be removed. So I thought about surrendering myself, because it says they have to take you west of the Mississippi, so maybe I just got to get a free trip to Oklahoma. So I don't know, I might be a big speculator and get arrested by some sheriff. So there's that one, the one that requires removal and a bounty. There's a law that's still in the books that says you can't give Indians liquor or firearms, and I will assure you, on every reservation, there are both liquor and firearms. And there are a couple of other ones that deal with business relationships with the Indians and not being able to have these business relationships. After the Civil War, the first Florida Reconstitution was redone in 1868. So this was Florida's Reconstruction Constitution. The Reconstruction Constitution says that all the laws before that are still in force. The Reconstruction Constitution also gave the Seminole people a House member and a Senate member in Florida's government. But that was taken out once that first Florida Reconstruction government, that election, the next election they had, where they kind of started going back the old way, they redid the Constitution and took that out. Where do I think I'm going? Where do I think we're going with Indian law in Florida? This is it. This is my coup d'etat. This is my prediction for you might see in your practice. I think you're going to see with the Seminole tribe in Florida, you're going to see an expansion of gaming on a couple of locations. I think you're going to see a new Seminole reservation for the displaced Tampa community where the Hard Rock is now. All those people just kind of live like out in Tampa. Some of them Brandon, some of them St. Pete, some of them live in Lakeland. Seminole tribe has a pretty large piece of land over in Polk County near Lakeland. I think that's going to become their reservation, but it will just be a reservation, not an economic thing. I also see them expanding their business portfolio into new industries. They're already the second largest cattle producer in the state of Florida. The first is the Church of Latter-day Saints. I see them going further down that road with agriculture. In terms of Miccosukee, I see them expanding gaming at their existing site in Miami. Hard to tell if they ever do anything on that where they have that rest stop on 75, but I see them expanding that. And I also see them continuing to expand their efforts for environmental protection. There's a question that deals with, they believe that they have, under the Miccosukee Designation Act, which sets up part of their reservation, they believe that they have exclusive authority under that law for a certain portion of the Everglades. So I see them continuing that fight. I also see them continuing fighting efforts by the United States government to tax certain Indian revenues. So there'll be environment tax and possible expansion gaming. Porch, I think Porch is going to be the third tribe with a casino in Florida. I think that little 2 acres, I think they will put a facility there. They'll put their parking structure on the Alabama side. Alabama has not been that receptive to them in terms of letting them do the type of gaming they want to do. So I see them expanding into North Florida big time. That's it. I can keep going, but I know you guys are going to, sir?
One last burning question. So how did the Seminole tribe as a tribe feel about the name in Tallahassee, the football team and so forth? What was the dynamic, political dynamics there?
Well, it's interesting that you asked that, because the lady that I was talking a little bit about before I got started, she was an instrumental part of that. So going forward, when that issue comes up again, if it does, it'd be interesting to see how it works out. But, you know, they the Seminole tribe of Florida has been very supportive of that effort. They have a great relationship with the tribe. The university really goes out of its way to bend over backwards to help tribal members go to FSU, seek educational opportunities and things like that. So I think in the near future it will continue, but you know, as people become more sensitive and as times change, you know, who's to say? Thank you, guys.
He's gonna run, so we're just gonna give him a gift now. I guess you guys, if you need to use the restroom, go ahead and use the restroom. We want to thank Travis for coming. I know he came a long way on short notice from D.C. We do have a few small departing gifts for you on behalf of NALSA.
We got you a maroon blanket. Seminole colors, just so there's no bad blood there.
Yeah.
And then from your work in South California, I was actually out there last week for the National Native American Law Student Association meeting, and got something from California.
Thank you so much. Right,
thank you.
Oh, okay. Okay.
I think I heard Jeff said.